times a year. If you like cleanses, this is, I don't want to say it's easy to somebody who's never done one, but it definitely is easy if you are a cleanser. It's an easier cleanse to do.
Yeah. Well, this has been my very first cleanse. And
good.
It was, you know, obviously it's really good to have someone along for the ride, help keep you motivated, keep your mental constitution in check, you know, don't give up. So that was definitely very helpful. And it was an easy cleanse. I think a lot of that, what really helped is that I cut out cheese and wine, my favorite things, a few days beforehand. And I think that really helps to just kind of, so you're not, well, except for I did eat that piece of pizza for lunch.
But also, you know, what helps the most on this cleanse is those Oxy Powder pills. Like,
yes,
I
absolutely
addicted. I love the Oxy Powder pills because they will do what a saltwater flush does to you, but they do it in a healthy way.
In a healthy way, without that horrendous taste.
Yeah.
You're right.
I love the Oxy Powder pills. So, I mean, and you don't want to obviously take those every day on a daily basis, but like if I go out on the weekend and, you know, I'm going to a barbecue and I'm drinking beer and this and that, and hey, let's say I have an audition the next day, I'm going to take some Oxy Powder pills the night before and I'm going to, you know, lose that bloating and sodium bloating and all that bad stuff.
Well, everyone is always worried about putting on those winter pounds with Thanksgiving and Christmas. We're all worried about that. And that's, you're exactly right with the Oxy Powder.
Yeah.
It's kind of a cheat thing, but it is healthy. It's healthy for you and you've got to cleanse the stuff out of your gut. You know, like I said here, the World Health Organization is saying processed meats, sausages, and bacon causes cancer, bowel cancer. It's probably enough evidence, they say, it's probably carcinogenic, and it's based on how much meat you're putting in your body. And so many people eat tons of meat, way more than is recommended. So, and what people don't understand is that can stay in your intestines for years.
Yeah, red meat and pork especially.
You'll never cleanse it out. And so that's why I recommend the Oxy Powder above everything if that's where you got to start. But again, we are running a special on it. So now is the time to go ahead and try this liver cleanse pack because it is on sale.
The knowledge of the ancients, tried and true, trusted herbs and extracts fused with the latest nutraceutical science. Introducing the all-new Ancient Defense Herbal Immunity Blend, crafted with over 14 key ancient herbs and extracts to supercharge and prepare your body for what experts admit is the most dangerous season of the year. We have rejected hundreds of other formulations in our quest to bring you what is simply the most powerful and comprehensive proprietary formula that we have ever created in the realm of herbal immunity. For the last 2 years, our team has been working with top doctors, nutritionists, and chemists to develop the ultimate nutraceutical formulation. Experience the benefits of combining over 14 ancient herbs and extracts with exciting new advances in nutraceutical science. Now is the time to secure Ancient Defense for you and your family. Visit AncientDefense.com or call 888-253-3139. That's AncientDefense.com.
Break down why you're so proud of these filters.
Well, I mean, this the Alexa Pure is really a culmination of all of my experience. It was posed to me as an extremely challenging project. They wanted a product that would actually operate without any electricity, so it had no pressure. You had to do it all by gravity, and they really effectively said, we need everything imaginable to be removed efficiently, way higher than 99%. And so the result was, it's an extreme challenge. Worked on it for quite a long time. And basically what we've done is we've created the only filter, to my knowledge, that hits all three. It will remove effectively all the major metals, all the major nonmetals such as fluoride. It will take out all known microbiological threats, including viral, bacterial, and cysts. And it will take out organic chemicals, pretty much everything, without exception. It's a very, very powerful device. I don't believe that there's anything else out there in the world that can do that, especially under gravity flow conditions. The fit and finish are fantastic. No compromise was made on the quality of the construction. So, I mean, it's really a remarkable achievement on their part. And I feel very proud, actually, to be part of the team that put that together.
What's your view overall on fluoride?
Well, okay, so we actually tested against both the fluoride ion and the fluorosilicate that you mentioned, which is the additive that people put into water under federal control. And basically, we removed both of them with equal efficiency. So we wanted to be sure that no matter how fluoride is added to the water, it can be intercepted and removed. So that's how we've dealt with that. All I can tell you is that we tested against all known fluoride chemicals that are added to water, the new ones and the old ones, and we removed them all of equal efficiency.
And it's your belief that this is the best gravity-fed filter of the design out there available to the public?
Without a doubt. I mean, most of these gravity flow filters are at best simple particulate filters. They remove dirt and debris, sediment. They're not going to be capable of intercepting a viral particle to the degree we're talking quantitative reduction below detection. No one can touch that kind of capability.
Well, I'm impressed, and I want to thank you so much for your time today. It is the Alexa Pure Pro family of water filtration systems available discounted exclusively at InfoWarsStore.com. I want to thank Mr. Red Hawk for allowing us to be part of the launch of this. It's on sale right now for their main unit, $177. Leading competitors that aren't even as good or more than that. And they've also got the survival spring type straw system for survival that is an absolute must-have.
Joining me in the studio is Zoltan Isfahan. He is founder of the Transhumanist Party. You are now, Zoltan, taking a bus tour. Is that right? You're going across country with your, I think it's the Immortality Bus. Is that what it's called?
Indeed. It is a bus that looks essentially just like a coffin, and we're trying to provoke a conversation about life extension.
Okay. All right. And we've got a video, and I want to run this video and ask you about what you're doing with this and why you would do this. We got a video of you getting a chip put in. Are you guys ready to roll that video? Can we do that? Okay, let's roll that video.
Do you have the chip already built into the thing?
Or yep, it's already in the injector.
Okay.
So it's sterilized and ready to go.
Yeah.
There we go. See that little pop feeling?
That was not.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I've done much worse over the last few days.
How long ago was this?
About 5 weeks ago.
Yeah. Jammed it in the ladder.
Here, we'll give it some blood.
It's a pretty big needle. It's hard to show. Look, there's some blood. But it's a 60-second procedure. In fact, maybe it's a 10-second procedure done quickly.
Everybody wants to see the blood involved here.
It's definitely, it hurts more than a normal needle. That's for sure. But it's a pop.
Are you feeling any more?
And they're putting that in your hand. For people who are listening on the radio, they're putting a chip in your hand.
Who are all these people?
Indeed, yes.
And what is this chip going to do?
Well, it's very rudimentary, honestly. It doesn't really do much, but for example, with the bus, if you have the right software and the right technology, you can start your bus by waving your hand over the ignition instead of having a key. Or, for example, to get into the Alex Jones studio, you could just swipe your hand at the security and that would let you right in. In the future, though, it's going to be able to do things like you can pay with it. You can it'll monitor your temperature, your hydration levels, and maybe even tell you whether you're getting enough iron from broccoli or something like that. Mm-hmm. So it's going to do a lot of different things like that.
And then, of course, the government can also track your position all the time with it.
So that is absolutely a concern. It's a concern of mine. But at the same time, you know, I'm sort of like the iPhone or the smartphones. You know, I guess there's a trade-off between your surveillance and security issues versus the government kind of prying into your life.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's always a trade-off. And, you know, I was one of the first people to get an iPhone. I got the very first iPhone on the very first day. I love technology. And I got to say, when I'm finished with this contract, I'm going back to some kind of a burner phone because I'm just fed up with the surveillance state. And so I'm willing, now I've looked at this and it's like, I will put up with a lot of inconvenience for my privacy because I think that's something that I don't want to give up. But let me ask you about health concerns. Aren't you concerned about the health issues of having that there? Because there's been some reports of animals who've gotten these kinds of chips, developed tumors at the site of that. This is something you put in fairly recently. There hasn't been a lot of history with these kind of chip implants. Are you concerned about possible health effects?
So, yes, I am. But so far, at least in the biohacker community, I haven't heard of anything negative specifically with anyone that has received this chip. Now, it's really the size of a grain of rice. It's tiny. That said, I do want to say, you know, my wife is a surgeon, and she said, you know, you do need to be cautious that what if this got free and went into the bloodstream and clogged an artery or something. So there are dangers like that. However, I have not heard of one like that. And I think a lot of people bring up a lot of the dangers, but so far there's very little evidence that would prove contrary to this. Again, not that many people have had it, and I'm very happy that I did it. I would probably do another one. I'm a big advocate for cranial implants. You know, as you may know, there's about 500,000 people in the world right now that have cranial implants, brain implants. Most of them are cochlear implants that help with deafness so that people can hear. But some are already working towards epilepsy or working to help with Alzheimer's. So I think the era of implants is coming. And it's not, you know, even though I got this tiny thing in my hand, we're talking on the next 10 years, many people are going to be doing. It's a multi-billion dollar industry. And the real question is, how can we get the public to feel secure with them? And especially, how can we make sure the government doesn't abuse it?
Yeah, yeah. And of course, part of that is informed consent. I mean, personally, if I'm looking at this, I want to know that there's enough of a history with something, anything that I put in my body, whether it's an implant or whether it's a vaccine or, you know, anything that is new, I want to know what the history of this is. I want to see the studies. I want to see studies that have been done by people besides the people who created the device or who created the vaccine to know if it is something that's safe. And the important part of that is not only the informed part of that, but it's also the consent part of that. As somebody who is running in a political party, would you support mandatory implants of people?
No, of course not. But what I would support is development from the government, you know, putting real money into it. For example, through Obama's Brain Initiative, $70 million is now going to DARPA, and they are trying to develop a chip to help with depression from soldiers coming back from wars and conflict zones. And I think that's an excellent use of, you know, cranial implants is to try to cure something like depression. I
mean, do you really believe that that's the mission of DARPA?
No. I'm just saying
Seriously. I mean, DARPA has used these kinds of things, benign uses, and come up with it and said, you know, we just want these killer robots because we might have to go into a nuclear power plant like Fukushima someday. If you go back and you look at the history of DARPA, there's an excellent book. Alex has interviewed the author, Andy Jacobson, The Pentagon's Brain, going back to the 1950s, the 1960s. I mean, DARPA is there to create weapon systems. They're not there to help people. And, you know, when I look at these brain system, these brain initiatives that DARPA is part of, I have to remember that after World War II, after the Korean War, they were doing frontal lobotomies on people. Massive front, the Pentagon was doing. You got PTSD, we'll give you a frontal lobotomy. This allows them to do this electronically, not having to use, you know, in a much cleaner way. Okay. So I mean, again, it comes down to the element of trust and the whole fact that DARPA would come out with these programs and put a beard on it and say, oh, this is for peaceful, benign use. I just don't buy it.
Well, and I understand your worries. And of course, you're older than me, so you've seen more of the history of DARPA. But at the same time, I think we are really just talking about depression for soldiers. So it's hard to see how that could go wrong. Now, I do understand about the war machines. You're right. There is a long history of developing, you know, war toys. And frankly, my political party and myself are pretty against war. In fact, one of our main initiatives is to try to divert money from defense and bomb making and wars to health, to science and technology. So I'm definitely I wouldn't say anti-military, but a huge part of my platform is pulling money away from the military and putting it directly into scientists' hands.
Yeah, I would like to pull the money away from the military and pull it out of the government's hands, quite frankly. I would like for us to be able to make our own decisions, to make our voluntary associations, to fund our own research if we wish, to be able to afford to buy whatever we wished for our own health. But of course, you know, as long as we send all of our money to Washington and then have them make those decisions for us, that won't happen. Let's talk a little bit about your transhumanist party. Let's talk about the platform here. Here's the first one. Implement a transhumanist bill of rights mandating government support of longer lifespans via science and technology. I want to know what the bill of rights is, but you kind of lost me there when you use the word mandating, okay? Because I'm not really big on mandates, especially when it's something that's coming from the federal government.
No, of course, and mandate is kind of a strong word. But basically, we want to have it so that, and this is one of the reasons why I'm driving this bus across the country. We're going to be delivering this transhumanist bill of rights to the U.S. Capitol building in about 5 weeks. And We want to make it so that politicians cannot step into the way of people's health. We feel that politicians throughout history, for example, with George W. Bush stopping stem